Good morning. Good to see everyone out this morning. In the way of announcements, first of all, just welcome. Glad to see you here today. If you're visiting, if you will, stick around a few minutes and let us get to know you and fill out a visitor card. And if you need communion supplies, if you will, just raise your hand and we'll help you get those this morning for the service. A few things going on today is immediately after the service, we'll have lunch downstairs. So if you're visiting, you're our guest, please join us for lunch. And then after lunch, we'll come back for the devotion right after, around 1:15, 1:30, right in that area. There'll be no late afternoon 5 p.m. Bible study today, though, or devotion. So just immediately after the meal service. Wednesday, if you're able, come back to the 7 p.m. Bible study. And Brian is traveling, so two things. Keep him in our prayers as he travels this week. And then he won't have a Bible study Thursday. So he'll be leaving immediately after the service this morning. A few other things coming up will be on the prayer request. Lynn's having surgery Tuesday, hip surgery, so we'll keep her in our prayers. Again, Brian's traveling. My Uncle Holland Gibson in Raleigh has bladder cancer. He'll start treatments soon. He's 94, so keep him and his family in our prayers. Vicky's mother, Alomas, not doing well. And then there's many on the prayer list. There's if you grab a bulletin, there's a bunch of folks on the prayer list there. And a few things coming up will be March 2nd, Carrie's Ladies Day. Carolina Men's Fellowship on Saturday, March 9th. If you crave Verena Ladies Day on March 9th, there's a marriage seminar in Raleigh Church of Christ March 9th. And a Last to Leader convention coming up March 29th through the 31st. So anyway, lots of events going on. And also there's a Tri-City School of Preaching. If you'd like to audit that class, you're welcome to join online. It's a distant learning class. It starts February 6th through April 2nd. And the topic is, he's covering is minor prophets. So Mr. David B. Jones will be conducting this class online. And I'll post this on the back if anyone's interested. And with that, let's go to God in prayer. All right, dear God, thank you for the day you've given us and our blessings and Lord, our ability to come together and freely worship you this morning. Lord, we're thankful for the teachers who come out and provided lessons, and those who drove distances, those who got kids ready, or all those who just went above and beyond this morning just to get here to worship you this morning. Lord, we're thankful for Brian for bringing us a message this morning. And Lord, as we continue, we pray that everything we do in our worship is according to your will. And Lord, be with those that were mentioned on the sick list and those that are in the bulletin. We pray you be with those folks and their families. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Number 54, if you'll turn with me to number 54. Holy, 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 number 54.
Holy, holy, holy.
Holy, holy, holy,
954. 954. Jesus Loves Me. 954. Want all the young people to sing out. Help me with this song. 954. Jesus Loves Me.
Jesus loves me.
For the Lord's Supper, let's sing number 603. Number 603. I am mine no more. I am mine no more. 603.
This is a blessed Lord's Day upon which we are able to come together to worship God and to remember the great sacrifice that was made for us at Calvary. Isaiah wrote about the suffering of the Christ, Isaiah 53, and beginning with verse 7, he says, "He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was there any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed and shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall he, my righteous servant, justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities." Shall we pray for the bread? Most holy, righteous, heavenly Father, we do thank thee this day. As we reflect back upon that scene, that dreadful day that our Lord and Savior offered himself up as a sacrifice for us. Father, we thank thee so very much for thy love, for thy mercy, and for thy gift. We pray, Father, as we partake of this bread, which brings to our remembrance the body of our Lord that was hung upon that tree, that we may reflect back and think about those things and take upon ourselves the grief that was endured by him because of our sin. And we thank thee for this bread, and may it bring to our remembrance that body that was offered for us. Through Christ Jesus our Lord, we pray. Amen. O Lord, we come before thee again, thanking thee for this cup, the fruit of the vine, which represents the blood that thy Son poured out at Calvary's tree, the blood that is able to cleanse man of his sin and justify us and allow us to come into thy presence. Father, as we reflect upon that sacrifice, may we take of this in a manner pleasing unto thee and beneficial to our souls. Through Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. Having completed the Lord's Supper, we're going to take an opportunity to pray for the offering. There's a collection box in the back on the right as you go out if you wish to contribute to the work here. The funds being collected will be used for the furtherance of the gospel in this area and others. Shall we pray? Holy Father, we thank Thee for this beautiful day. We thank Thee for the measure of health that we enjoy that allows us to rise up from our beds and come and worship Thee this day. We're thankful, O God, for all the material blessings in this life, for surely our cup doth run over with blessings. We have received so much, way more than we could even think or ask. But Father, we also thank Thee for the spiritual gifts we have in Christ Jesus. We thank Thee for the love of the brethren, for this congregation and Thy people. We thank Thee for all the good things that Thou hast done for us every day of our life. Father, we praise Thee, we thank Thee, we glorify Thy name through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
The scripture reading this morning will be taken from Exodus chapter 34, verse 5 through 10. Exodus 34, 5 through 10, if you'd like to follow along. And the Lord descended in a cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping the mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquities and transgressions and sins, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children until the third and fourth generations. And Moses made haste and bowed his head towards the earth and worshiped. And he said, if now I have found grace in thy sight, O Lord, let my Lord, I pray thee, go among us, for it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquities and our sins, and take us for thine inheritance. And he said, behold, I make a covenant before all of thy people. I will do marvels, such as have not been done in all the earth, nor in any nation, and all the people among which thou shalt see the work of the Lord, for it is a terrible thing that I should do with thee. Exodus chapter 34, verses 5 through 10.
Morning. Good to see you. If you don't mind, just go ahead and turn it over to Exodus 34. We'll be there in just a minute. I want to begin by asking for your kindness and forgiveness after we're finished this morning. I have to rush out. When I had booked my airfare, I didn't realize it was 2:15 that we're leaving. And so got to get to the airport, and I'm a little anxious about that. I always feel good once I get to the gate and are able to sit down for a few minutes before they start boarding. So until I get through security, I'll be a little anxious about that and get to the gate. But if you can keep me and our family in your prayers as I travel this week. As we think about what is said in Exodus 34, as I was thinking about that, I was thinking about, you ever find yourself doing things your parents used to do or currently do? Now, commercials can be hit and miss, right? There's a definite effort in a lot of commercials to be funny. Now, as a preacher, you know this all too well. God did not make us comedians, did he? Although sometimes we try to tell jokes, and sometimes they hit, and sometimes they miss. And so I'm glad God didn't make me a comic or a court jester. Commercials can be that way, too. But occasionally, there's one or two that can actually make you chuckle. One of the ones recently that I have found enjoyment in is one commercial with an insurance company, and they present this idea of different people becoming their parents. And you have the guy in the middle there, the counselor, trying to help people overcome these things. And sometimes they make me kind of laugh as I think about the things I see people doing, as I see myself doing, like my parents did. And we do kind of become our parents, don't we? They have such a big influence on us. Our parents, our grandparents, our families, we all kind of develop a way of thinking about the world that comes from our parents. And for a lot of things, that can be good, or it can just be one of those things that just happens. It's neither good or bad. It's just how we think. But along the way, sometimes there are some things that our parents and our family do that maybe aren't beneficial. I want you to go, if you will, to Exodus 34 with me as we think about this kind of mindset. Now, today's message really kind of wraps up a series of lessons about this idea of overcoming sin of the past, breaking patterns of behavior. And I think that was one of the messages that God is trying to get across to the Israelite people. Now, in a previous lesson, we were looking at Exodus chapter 3 in that conversation that Moses has at the burning bush. And he's asking, God is calling him to go and to rescue his people out of Egyptian bondage. And as you remember, Moses makes all kinds of excuses and tries to negotiate his way out of that. In amongst all of that, one of the things that God reveals to Moses is his nature and his identity. When he says, I am who I am. When you go to them, tell them that I am has sent you. Well, later in the book of Exodus, this conversation comes up once again as Moses goes back on the mountain to be with God and to again receive those two tablets with the first initial commandments on them. As God is beginning to reveal this to him, we get to Exodus 34, 5. If you will, go back and notice the text with me. It says, the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of God. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, that's that word Yahweh, the Lord, Yahweh, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. And so he sets up there kind of the duality of God, that God is a forgiving God. God is a merciful God. God is a God who seeks to provide forgiveness. Yet there's the other side of that, right? He's also a just God. You go on in verse 7, he says, but who, God, will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and the fourth generation. Now, you in this text see that God is both forgiving, merciful, and also just. That God cannot allow sin to go unpunished or unatoned for. Sin demands atonement. In one of our lessons, we looked at that concept. Sin is costly. It's costly to us, and it's also costly to God. And so God must punish the guilty. A sentence must be declared upon them. And so much of the text deals with what? God providing mercy, being a merciful God, to a guilty people. That's us. God provides atonement for us by himself, by sending his son to bear the guilt of our sin, by being punished for us, by shedding his blood to cleanse us. That's the story of Scripture, the great love story of God. But I want you to, for just a minute, to concentrate on those last phrases. Visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation. Now, when I first read that, it almost sounds as though this concept of inherited sin and guilt may be true. And that the concept of original sin is biblical. Is that true? When he says he's visiting the sin of the fathers upon his children and his grandchildren, his great-grandchildren, and so on? Is that what he means? Well, that can't be what he means. And there's a text that clears this up for us. That's not the meaning of this text. If you go to Ezekiel 18, that kind of mindset is very present in that chapter. I invite you to read that whole text. Ezekiel is dealing with this very concept of original sin or inherited sin. Verse 20 kind of really gives us a conclusion to that argument. He says, the soul who sins shall die. The soul who sins. The son shall not suffer the iniquity of the father, or the guilt of the father, nor the father suffer the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon himself, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. In a judgment sense, I do not bear the guilt of my father's sin, nor will my children bear my guilt. That's between me and God, me and judgment, not them. Now, there needs to be, for all of us, an understanding there's a difference between consequences and guilt. Now, I may have to bear some consequences of the sin of someone else, of my father or mother or someone else in my family or someone else in my friend network. But that's not the same thing as spiritual guilt. And so consequences is not necessarily infer punishment. And so we need to clear that up right away. So we go back to Exodus 34. What is meant by visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation? What does God mean about that? Well, that word visiting is an interesting terminology. When I go to visit someone, what am I doing? I'm going into their home, possibly. I'm going into their life. I'm going there to meet them, to greet them, to share with them in what's going on in their life, and them with me as well. In the sense that God visits us, he does on a constant basis, doesn't he? There's a constant kind of measurement where God is always seeing us. He's visiting us. He's inspecting us. He's checking in on us. So you think about this concept of God visiting us. It does not mean, cannot mean, that we inherit our father's or mother's guilt. But what it does mean, however, is that we do at times inherit tendencies and habits of our fathers and mothers. That's obvious, isn't it? We take on many of the attributes of those who came before us. I want to give you an example of where we see this concept of inherited sin from the inherited tendencies towards sin. Let me say it that way. The inherited tendencies or temptations of those who came before us. If you look at the patriarchs and this model of deception that first occurs in Abraham. You may recall in your mind the life of Abraham early on. Abraham, of course, in chapter 12 is called by God to leave his homeland and to travel to a land God will show him. Abraham does that very thing. As Abraham continues to live his life, we find out that he has a wife named Sarai, later Sarah, and they travel around. They go to different places as God directs them. They find themselves in different kingdoms. In Genesis 12, as they travel down to Egypt, as they approach it, the text tells us that Abraham becomes kind of concerned. And he's concerned about his welfare, as Sarah, we find out, is a very beautiful lady. Notice the text in Genesis 12 and verse 11. When he was about to enter Egypt, he said to Sarai, his wife, I know that you are a woman beautiful in appearance. And when the Egyptians see you, they will say, this is his wife. Then they will kill me, but they will let you live. Say you are my sister, that it may go well with me because of you, that my life may be spared for your sake. And so Abraham devises this plan of deception with the Egyptians. Now, what's interesting is this is partly true. They are related, close relations. And in a sense, she is his half-sister. But she's also his wife. Now, he's not outright lying, but what is he doing? He's being deceptive. Now, that may seem like an innocent thing. But what's interesting is that's not the only time he does it. Later on, if you go to Genesis 20, he does the same thing as they come into the Negev. And there again, they're in another kingdom, and he devises the same thing with Abimelech. The practice of deception. Now, what might seem as a little lie can often grow, can it? Or a small deception can become something much bigger. What we allow as permissible in our behavior can lead to bigger things, and it can with our families. This is a thing that continues. If you go later into the patriarch Isaac's life, you have a very similar thing, don't you? With Rebecca. Again, they are traveling. He again asks that she say she's his sister in order to protect himself. Well, he's following a pattern, right, that Abraham had left behind. Was it something he learned from Abraham? I can't say with all surety, but it sure was something that Abraham found himself doing. Well, is this something we see continued? What's interesting that Isaac asked Rebecca to be deceptive for him. What happens later on? Rebecca repays the favor by being deceptive with Isaac. You remember what happens with Jacob and Esau? As Isaac is about to give the blessings upon Esau, what is it that Rebecca does? Well, she creates this plan where Jacob will steal the blessing of Esau. Esau has gone out into the field to hunt game. She then dresses Jacob to look and even have the hair put on his arm so that his father will be deceived into thinking he's Esau. She makes a meal that will be pleasing to Isaac, and the deception works. Well, you see how one lie is becoming much bigger and how the permissibility of what happens with Abraham is something that seems to continue down through the patriarchs. What about the sons of Jacob? Well, what began as a little deception when you get to the patriarchal sons of Jacob, become something much bigger. You remember they become very jealous of Joseph, their younger brother. They are jealous to the point they have begun to hate him. They hate the sight of him. And so one day they decide at first, we're going to just kill him. But the older brother talks them out of that, and they throw him into the pit, eventually selling him to slavers, and eventually he's taken on into Egypt and sold into slavery. But if you go to Genesis 37, I was just rereading this and thinking, wow, I just, you know, how far we can allow ourselves to fall into deception. If you go down to Genesis 37, verse 31, the text tells us that they took Joseph's coat, that coat his father had given him, the coat of many colors. They dip it in the blood of a goat. They then take that to the father. Now, you'll notice they never, at least it's not recorded, that they ever outright lie to their father. But I think we could all agree they're being very deceptive. They present him this coat that they know was dipped into a goat's blood. They give that to their father. And what's the conclusion of Jacob? Verse 33, he says, verse 32, they say, please identify whether it is your son's robe or not. Now, again, they're not outright lying. They, in some way, have justified what they're doing in their mind. Their father then concludes, rightly, it is my son's robe. And he goes on to conclude, because of the deception of his sons, that it was an animal that has torn him into pieces. What I find fascinating is go down to verse 35. As Jacob becomes very distraught and upset about this, verse 35 says, all his sons and all his daughters rose up to comfort him. Now, every one of those young men, all 10 of them, know that what he believes about his son is a lie. They watch him cry, knowing that he's crying for no reason, that Joseph is alive. But you see this cycle of sin, this pattern that we get ourselves into, and how that what we may consider as something small becomes something so much larger over time. Sin has a way of working like that in our lives. Now, when we think about the home and the way God has called for parents and grandparents and the family to raise their children, it's a place that, as Paul says in Ephesians 6:4, that it is a place where our children should be trained in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. That should be a place where they're trained not in deception, not in evil practices, but in things that would lead to righteousness. But as all of us understand, though that's what I desire, that's not always what happens, is it? And so we think about this idea of training our children and ourselves. I was thinking about this, and Proverbs 19:18 came to my mind, and I like the way this is worded in like the King James, New King James Version, but this is the English Standard. It says, discipline your son, for there is hope. Some older translations will have, for while there is hope. I don't know which one is the most proper translation, but at least those translations convey the idea that we have a time frame in which we can impart to our children, impart to others, the kind of training that would lead them to good things, lead them to righteousness, lead them to being more like God, being more like Christ. We all know that there comes a time when our children step out of the home, when that becomes less possible. And so we need to do like Paul told the Ephesians, to make the best use of the time or opportunity that we have. And so as we think about these things, I want to ask one big question. And as we've been thinking about the sin and the kind of breaking away from the pattern of the world to do what God has called us to do, how do we as individuals and as families break the cycle of sin? How do we break away from those things? What are some things that would be helpful for us to think about as we try to negotiate this life together? As we try to impart to one another things that would bless our spiritual walk and not tear us down. I think there are a couple, I'm sure like most things, you could add to these or even alter them in some way to make them sound better. But these are a few things that I think are important. Number one, it is a thing that is obvious to understand, but maybe not so easy to implement. But number one, we need to set our heart on serving the Lord, making him the focus of what we're doing in this life. This morning in our Bible study, one of the things, the concepts we were looking at in regard to worship, is this idea that we can approach worship in one of two ways. And I think this is where most of the false worship in our world comes from, is a misunderstanding of these two things. I can either approach worship from the concept of I'm making God the focus, the center of my worship. He is what I'm striving to please. He is the one who is the one that I'm trying to glorify. Or I can make myself the center of worship. And far too often, we do that. In the church, we do that. And even this morning, maybe that's a struggle that we're dealing with, is overcoming this idea that I'm the center of my worship. If I'm leaving here asking the question of, well, I sure didn't, or making the statement, I sure didn't get much out of that this morning, or this morning, man, I got a ton out of that. I think we've come with the wrong attitude. I don't like either one of those statements. Because what our focus should be on is God. What did I give to God today? How could I have been better today at giving to God? The focus needs to be what it should be. And the same is true with our lives. That should be the mantra of Christians in all of their life. In Chronicles, the first book of Chronicles, chapter 22, as David is preparing Solomon to take over the leadership of the nation, and as they are discussing the building of a temple to God, one of the things that David tries to really press upon Solomon is found in verse 19. He says, "Now set your mind and heart to seek the Lord your God." I think it's interesting, before he ever goes on to talk about building the temple, the first thing he's trying to impress upon him is the need to focus to place your focus where it should be. That we need to focus on God. That we need to make him the centerpiece. If you go to Matthew chapter 4, as Satan is trying to tempt Christ into sin, you remember after each of those temptations, what does Jesus do in Matthew 4? Verse 4, I think again in verse 6 and in verse 10. Each time Jesus responds with what? With Scripture. In verse 4, he responds to Satan when Satan tries to tempt him with food. He says, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Notice where the focus of Jesus is. Where is he placing it? Where is his attention? Verse 10, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. Again, who's the focus? Where is his attention? Where is he driving toward? What's his aim? It's toward God. He's talking about setting your mind, your attention on God. When I make decisions in my life in regard to where I'm worshiping, to where I'm working, to where I'm living, how much of that is focused on God? Now, I would argue that all of it should be focused on God, and then I benefit as a side of all of that. But how easy is it for us to focus on ourselves and what will please us? In Hebrews chapter 12, as the Hebrews writer is talking about faith, and he's spent a whole chapter discussing the need of us to trust and rely on God. What does he say? Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, what should we do? Lay aside every weight and the sin which so which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. So the first thing we need to do is to lay aside the weight that holds us down. You're in a hot air balloon. Hot air balloons stay on the ground. Why? Because they got weights, right? You want to go up, what do you got to do? You got to release the weight. And then you can warm up the air in the balloon and it'll eventually rise. But first thing, you got to lay aside the weight. You're in a boat and you're trying to go out to sea. You're not going to go very fast when that anchor's hugged to the earth, is it? You got to lift the anchor up. You got to untie from the dock. You got to lay aside those things which hold you back. And then what should you do? Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of God, the right hand of the throne of God. And then he says, consider. When I consider something, what am I doing? I'm using my mind. I'm focusing it in a direction. He says, consider him, Jesus, make him the focus, who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. If my attention is where it should be, that danger of growing faint-hearted, of falling away, is going to be less likely. So number one, we need to set our attention, our focus, our heart where it should be. Our attention needs to be drawn toward God. Number two, in this regard, as we try to break the cycle of sin in our life, we need to identify our weaknesses. We need to recognize our tendencies toward sin. Where are you weak? Where's your struggle? As we reflect on this, what we understand is that this is a hard thing. It's not hard necessarily to take an inventory of our lives, but it is uncomfortable. Honesty about who and what we really are can be very uncomfortable. The older you get, the more you realize this. The more water that has gone underneath the bridge, the more troubling it is to look into those closets, to open them up, to seeing what's in there. But the more there is a need to do it. Anybody who's ever moved realizes something. The longer you've lived in one place and are moving to another, what do you have? The more junk you have. But man, isn't it tough to get rid of that junk? How many of us right now have junk? We know it's junk, but we hold on to it for some reason. How many of us in our closets at home have clothes that we haven't worn in who knows how long? How many of us have clothes that we've never worn, But we won't get rid of it because there might be a chance one day I want to wear it. Right? And the same is true in our lives in regard to sin. Sometimes we know that a certain pattern of behavior leads to a sin, but because we enjoy it, it's hard to get rid of it. Look at yourself. Know yourself. James reminds us in James 1, 13 and, through 15 that sin is one of those things that's very personal, isn't it? Now, we try to blame other people for our sin. We try to lay it off somewhere else. It's not my fault. It's somebody else's. It's got to be. It can't be me. Yet what we realize and what we know deep down inside is that it is really about us. The reason I can't let go of the bottle is because I like the way it makes me feel sometimes. The reason why I don't clean up my language is because it kind of makes me fit in with everybody else. The reason why I don't show up to worship is sometimes I just like that bed in the morning. It really is about us. We need to own that. James says that sin is something that grows out of the cares and desires of the heart. We need to make sure that in our lives, we're not holding on to things that hold us back. Remember what Hebrews 12 said? Lay aside the weight. We got to let go of it. We've got to do some spring cleaning in our lives. We need to recognize where we're weak. God made us a promise through the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 10, didn't he? 12 and 13. No temptation has overtaken any of us, which is not common to man. You're not dealing with things that others aren't. Right? You don't have a special circumstances that other people can't understand. Now, I may not be going exactly what you are, but I know there is somebody. God hasn't allowed Satan or temptation to make a special attack on you that you can't overcome. He goes on to say, but he has provided what? A way of escape that you may be able to bear it. If you go back to James chapter 1, we often will look at 13 through 15, I have at least, and focused on those, but we need to focus on the next, what comes right after that, don't we? Get the full context. If you go on and read 16, he goes on to say, do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. That always piques my interest whenever the Bible says, do not be deceived. It makes me immediately think, am I being deceived by something? Maybe I ought to really listen. Do not be deceived. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. God doesn't change. God is always there. If you ever find yourself adrift from God, know for sure that you have left God. He's not left you. God never wanders off from you. He never leaves you. He'll never forsake you. If there's any forsaking, it's on my part. And then he goes on in verse 18, for of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. God has provided that way of escape. He's provided for us a way of truth to understand how we can overcome these things, that we can let go of sin and we can move forward into righteousness. We need to set our heart on serving God. We need to recognize our tendencies towards sin. And thirdly, we need to make a break with the influences us that lead us into sin. This may be the hardest for us, because it's very uncomfortable. But it is one of the most important steps. We cannot overlook it. We find ourselves continually being tripped up by sin. Maybe we should ask why. What am I doing? What kind of habits have I created in my life that lead me into this? Where could I make changes in my life in order to free myself from that outcome? In Colossians chapter 3 and verse 5, as Paul talks to the church about being new creations, being a new man created in Christ, he does remind us that as we do that, as a part of that, what should we do? Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you? What is it that is earthly in you? What ties you to this place? What prevents you from being the kind of servant of God that you ought to be? You need to really be honest about that, and you need to make change. Sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, covetousness, which is idolatry, on account of these, the wrath of God is coming. Notice this. In these you too once walked. He's saying the Colossian brethren, those were things that you devoted yourselves to once. But you can't do that anymore. You've got to make a break with those things. Maybe that means that I need to make change in regard to who I'm hanging out with. There's a proverb that Paul quotes in 1 Corinthians 15:33 about this idea that we need to make a break with those who lead us astray. He says, bad company. Again, notice how he begins that. I want to skip that. Do not be deceived. In other words, what he's saying, you can be deceived, and many are. Do not be deceived. Bad company ruins good morals. If I'm trying to be a Christian and I spend 90% of my time, 75%, half my time, 10% of my time with those who are professed to do evil, I've got a weight in my life that's weighing me down. Where do you spend your time? Who do you spend it with? Are you spending it with people who uplift you? People who are striving like you are to be God, Christ-like? Or do you find yourself in company with those who are outside of God's favor? Those who are not trying to be Christians. I should think about that. Where do I find myself? Where are the places I find myself? Where do my eyes go? What am I allowing into my ears? Where is my attention and focus? Yeah, when you're at services and you're in the worship service, there are a lot of people here who are striving to be God-like, to be Christ-like. But we spend how many hours? You know, if you're here all the time, that's only 5 or 6 hours. Think about all the time that you're not with the church. Who are you spending your time with? What are you spending your time doing? Where are you spending your time? You tell me which of those has a greater focus of your attention. Now just imagine for those of us who only come 1 hour a week. I might say to you in that moment, okay, I think I know one reason why you're struggling. Let me show you how much focus and attention you're giving to God and His people, and how much attention are you giving to other things. Now just imagine if we changed that up and we did things just a little differently. In 1 Corinthians 5, 6, and 7, he says that when we have a little leaven, it leavens the whole lump. Leaven, obviously, is a symbolism of sin and temptation. Maybe temptation is a better way to think about that. But when we have ourselves exposed to a lot of evil things, what's going to happen? We're going to become like those evil things. It's going to be harder to stand up for the truth. What happens when we get rid of that little leaven? And the point here is you got a young man who's a Christian but has fallen into sin. And Paul's point to them is you need to deal with this. Because not only is his soul in danger, but so is yours. Because you're allowing this to go on. You're boasting about it. And your boasting is not good. You're not being loving to that brother when you allow them to continue in sin, knowing they are sinning. Deal with it. Get a little uncomfortable. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. Think about this idea of setting your mind, your attention on God, on serving the Lord, recognizing the tendencies in my life towards sin, making a break with those evil influences. I then need to replace those with good things. Now, you think about what we were talking about earlier, about, you know, we spend 5, 6, maybe 7 hours with the church a week. There's a lot of time there left, isn't there? Even if I take out all the time I'm asleep, there's still a lot of time. What am I filling that with? Am I filling it with prayer, with reading God's word, with doing good, with evangelism? Those are all good things, right? Those could fill in the gaps, and those would encourage me toward doing good things. When we remove one thing, there necessarily becomes a hole, doesn't there? And so we ask, what does it get filled with? And I'm not saying every minute of every day do you have to be doing something godly. But I do need to question everything I'm doing. And I need to do that constant inventory of my life and what is filling it. Again, in James chapter 1, we're spending a lot of time in James. What a wonderful study, isn't it, James? James, again, like Paul with the Colossians, is reminding them in verse 21 that they need to put away the evil influences in their life, the temptations that pull them down. He says, therefore, putting away all filthiness and rampant wickedness. But he doesn't stop there, does he? He gives us this idea that when I put that away, there leaves a hole and I need to fill it with something. And I need to think about what I'm putting in its place. Sometimes we can remove one wickedness just to gather onto something different. James says, don't do that. He says, get rid of those things and what receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. You need to remove the evil and bring in the good. And in verse 22, he gets into a discussion of what that really means. And in verse 22, he says, but be doers of the word. Right? You receive with meekness the word, and then what? It comes out. That's one of the beautiful things about the word of God. It changes us from the inside out. Again, I'll steal from my class this morning. You all should have been in there. Now, I'm sure Jody's class was great and the other ones. But we were talking about this idea of bearing fruit in our lives. In Matthew chapter 7, if you go on that text and you get down, I believe, to verse 15, he talks about being a fruitful tree. And that he lays up there the example of two trees. You have the diseased tree, which produces bad fruit. And you have the good tree, which produces good fruit. And he says that a diseased tree is not going to give you good fruit. When you've got sin in your life, you need to deal with that first. That has to be dealt with first. And then in its place, you begin to produce fruit. A plant that does not produce good fruit is worthless. We don't waste our time with plants that don't produce fruit. We want plants in our gardens that produce for us, don't we? You own a business. You want workers who produce good fruits, don't you? a worker who doesn't produce, who is coming to work and spending all their time on their phone, not doing any good for the company, eventually does what? You got to go home. Well, you don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. I got to get somebody who can do the work. What kind of fruit are we producing for God? James says, be doers of the word, not hearers only. That is a worthless kind of faith. That faith is not valuable to God. Colossians 3 and verse 1, if then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, keeping that focus where it should be. He says, verse 2, Colossians 3, set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. When we think about this idea, how do I break the cycle of sin in my life? The first thing is I need to figure out where I'm focused. What has my attention? What drives me? I need to recognize my tendency towards sin, toward those things that take me away from my purpose in life. My purpose is Christ. Then I need to make it my aim in life to get rid of the things that drive me away from Him. I need to make a break with those things that influence me toward evil. Whatever they be, whether they're people, places, interests in life. Are they things that lift me up or tear me down? I need to get rid of those things that tear me down spiritually. Replace those evil influences and bring in good things. If we want to break the cycle of sin in our lives, we have to do those things. We need to get uncomfortable for God. When you think about your life and breaking the cycle of sin that you see going on, the things that tear away at your spiritual well-being, and you consider where you find yourself, what you find yourself doing. I want to invite you this morning to begin that process of breaking free. If you're not a Christian, if you've never been baptized into Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, then it's going to be impossible for you to break the cycle of sin. First, you have to seek the atonement of God. That's the first step. Set your mind and attention on Him by obeying His gospel. This morning, if you're not a Christian, we want to help you out with that. If you're ready to be immersed into Christ with the forgiveness of your sins, that's why we're here. Maybe you're a Christian who isn't living like a Christian. Maybe that cycle of sin, that cycle of falling back into sin, sin of the past, maybe new sin in your life. Maybe that's going on with you. If you need forgiveness, you need to come forward and ask for God's forgiveness. We want to afford you that opportunity. Or if we can just pray with you, if we can help one another to find ways to overcome those things. If you have any need at all, please come as together we stand and as we sing.
925. I am resolved. I am
resolved. Thank you.
be seated. If you'll turn with me to number 756. 756. You'll turn with me to number 598. 598. 598. A common love.
Amen. Shall be closed in prayer. Blessed, dear Heavenly Father, eternal God, we thank you so much for this day you've given us. Dear God, we thank you for this morning that we've been able to come together as your people in this community to study your word and to worship you. Dear God, we pray for everyone that we've mentioned this morning. We pray for those that are on our hearts and minds. We pray for those that are under the weather. We pray that if it be your will, that they will have some measure of health restored. Dear God, we pray for those that have more seemingly permanent illnesses. We pray that in these different times in their lives, that these individuals can turn to you for eternal comfort that only you can provide. Dear God, we pray that you bless our time together here today. We pray that we have been able to strengthen one another. We pray that we have worshiped you in spirit and in truth and have learned further from your word. Dear God, we thank you for Brian and his family. We thank you for the messages that he brings to us on a regular basis. We pray that we can make ready application to your word to us in our lives in this time on this earth. Dear God, as we go out into the world now, we pray that you will keep us safe. We pray that you will bring us back together at the next appropriate time. Dear God, we thank you for all the blessings of this life. We know that each blessing that is good comes to us through you. We thank you most of all for Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.